Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. I hope that you are in for a plan to treat yourself tonight. Were you planning to treat yourself tonight? Cookies were great. There's even a better treat up here. Today is the day the Lord has made. We rejoice and are so glad in it. My friends, in this Advent season, we gather in the stillness of a beautiful winter evening to continue our Advent mission. There is so much focus on our Blessed Mom in this holy season, and that is the reason why we've chosen our theme for this Advent mission is the many faces of our Blessed Virgin Mary. Last week, we had Father Jim Gannon here, and he did a beautiful presentation on Our Lady of Guadalupe and her feast we just celebrated yesterday. Today, we are welcoming Julianne Stanz with us, a blessed soul and a wonderfully presenter that you will be thoroughly enjoying this evening. And I have to tell you why we've invited Julianne. First and foremost, Julianne brings her passion and her love of this Blessed Mom to us, as well as the Catholic faith, and finds such great joy in spreading that around to all of us. She is first and foremost a child of God. Julianne is a wife and a mom. She's a storyteller, an encourager, as well as, did you know, she's a beach glass hunter? Oh, yes, she is. And besides all of that, she is the director of parish life and evangelization for the Diocese of Green Bay. She's a national speaker. She is she's the author of a variety of books. One of her latest is Start With Jesus, How Everyday Disciples Renew the Church. Her most just released, in fact, I want to get my hands on a copy, it's so new, is Braving the Thin Places. She also publishes, if you watch or attend to our diocesan newspaper, The Compass, she has regular columns in there. In fact, I left extra copies on the table there for you tonight. Her wonderful column just this week was the B/Attitudes of Advent. And there we were reminded, if you look at that column, on how to be still like Mary and be attuned to what the world is providing us right now. So, awesome. So with that, I am so excited to present to you and help me welcome Julianne Stanz.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much. I could do a very Catholic thing. All of you all in the back, we could get you all to move up, but I see that you're nice and cozy. So I'm going to leave you down there, but I might kind of march down the center of the aisle and engage with you down there tonight. So I want to thank you all for being here and for being here at the parish mission tonight in this absolutely beautiful space. Look around you. The real treat tonight isn't the cookie downstairs, although that chili, I had two whole bowls of that. So, but the real treat tonight is growing closer in friendship with Jesus Christ and His Blessed Mother, and also taking the time as a family to just be tonight. You know, you've got school test-taking stuff going on, practicing for Christmas concerts, cookie baking, shopping. And yet, we are invited to tonight to just slow down and take time to be with each other, to be still. And who doesn't need that, right? We all need that. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself in a minute, but I have a handout for you on prayer. I have a lot of resources for you tonight. I'm very passionate about this topic. You can hear from my accent that I'm not a native Wisconsinite. For those that have heard me before, don't tell anyone if you know where I'm from. But any guesses from the little ones where they might think? England. My dad is English, actually, but I don't tell people that very much because You'll understand why in a minute. Yep, not English, but very close. Irish. Yes, I am Irish. And so I grew up with what they call Anglo-Irish. Very good. My dad is English, and my mom is Irish. And so I came here 20 years ago. And I will say, part of the reason I am Catholic is not just the presence of Jesus in the Eucharist, but it is the presence of the Blessed Mother in my own life. So we're going to talk about her tonight, and we're going to talk about her together. And I found this gorgeous prayer. It's written by the Sisters of Life. It's a prayer that I find a lot of people are not familiar with. So I'd invite you to pray this with me. Anytime it's bold, so there's only two responses. Mary, be with me, and I praise you, Jesus. You ready? Okay. So right now I want you to think about something that's weighing you down. Also for the kids, too, who are here, and our young adults and our youth. Something that's weighing you down. Maybe it's an exam. Maybe somebody's being mean to you at school. Maybe something isn't going right at work for the moms and dads or grandparents. Maybe it's a friend that you haven't talked to for a long time. Maybe it's a grandparent that passed away or a friend this year. I want you to just take a moment and think about that one thing that's really weighing on your heart. We're going to uplift all of these intentions that we hold in the silence of our heart as we sign ourselves as Catholics in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Mary, with your consent to become the Mother of God, torrents of grace poured forth upon the earth, opening up for me a path to follow. In times of loneliness, Mary. In times of toil and uncertainty. In times of grief, loss, or illness. In times of sadness or depression. In times of lost plans and broken promises. When I am anxious about the welfare of my family. When a job or financial stress weighs heavily on my heart. When I am discouraged by the weight of my sins. When I am tempted. When I am afraid. When the Lord calls me to greater kindness and love. When the Lord calls me to greater purity. On the wings of your fiat, Mary, I proclaim mine. Together we sing a Magnificat of praise for all the blessings in my life. For the gift of today. For the gift of loved ones. For the gift of my life. For creating me with a special purpose and plan. For never giving up on me, for your infinite love, for never leaving me, for your inexhaustible mercy, for laying down your life for me, for your presence in the Eucharist, for the greater good you will bring out of everything, especially in moments when I feel helpless and vulnerable, in the midst of uncertainty, in the midst of humiliation, in the midst of difficulty, in the midst of what appears as failure, for sending your mother to me in both sorrowful and joyful moments. And together with Mary we sing, the Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Isn't that a lovely prayer? I love this one. I pray this one a lot. So I want to talk to you a little bit about who I am, and I want to share a little bit about my passion for the Blessed Mother with you. I tend to speak very fast, and I was just home in Ireland like a week ago, so my accent is super strong right now. And I was on the phone tonight, actually driving out here, my phone rang in my car. It was Bluetooth, so I am safe, just in case anybody is wondering. And I was driving along, and it was, hello, Julianne. It was Bishop Ricken. He said, where are you going? I said, I'm heading out to a parish tonight. And he said, oh, that's nice. And then we talked for a little bit, because I work for Bishop Ricken. And then he said, gosh, you sound super joyful tonight, like really cheerful. And I said, I'm going to Assumption BVM in Pulaski, probably one of the most beautiful parishes in the diocese, to talk about Mary. I'm so excited. He's like, okay. Like, I can tell you're very excited. I'll pray for you all. So Bishop Ricken wanted to pass on his best regards to each one of you. He's in his chapel praying, actually, right now. during this special time. So he is lifting up all of your intentions and your families in prayer. And it was just a nice way to start off tonight. So I want to tell you a little bit about myself, and then we'll talk about Mary a little bit. A little bit about myself. I have three children. I live in Algoma, which is right on shores of Lake Michigan. Do you see the lighthouse there? And that little figure on its way out, that is me actually walking. I am not a morning person. The only thing that will get me up in the morning is the possibility of a sunrise over Lake Michigan. And so I was heading out one morning and somebody caught this picture of me. But I think it's a good image for the talk that we're going to give tonight. Jesus is the light. He is the lighthouse. But Mary is the dawn announcing his rising. That's a quote from St. John Paul II. Mary is like the sun that comes up every morning for us that helps us understand Jesus' love. I have three children, as I said. I have a 12. You know, my son, every time he comes to one of my talks, he's like this. Ugh. You know, she tells everybody I'm 12, 12 and a half. I have a 10-year-old, and I also have a 6-year-old as well. And I've been in the United States 20 years. 3 years ago, I became a U.S. citizen. So that was amazing and very hard process. Yeah, thank you. It was 3 years that I didn't get home because with the pandemic, Ireland shut down its borders. The country only opened up on November 8th, so I was able to head back home and see my family for the first time in 3 years, which was just amazing to me. As Deanne mentioned, I like to write. This is my book, Start With Jesus, and then this is my new one, which just came out. I just found out it just came out on Tuesday. So I'm pretty excited. If you follow or read any of my writings, Jesus, Mary, and real life all come together. I am a mom. I am a practical person. And so I often kind of pepper my writings or my books with just practical information that you can take into your own life. So tonight in our parish mission, it's Advent. And this is a time for us to really think about what we need in life. You know, are we in need of more energy or more time to pray, less school, more sleep? What is it that you're in need of right now? Because Advent is the time when you can really voice that. Now, I had a very unusual experience growing up in Ireland. I had an unusual mom. And my mom loved the Blessed Mother, but I will never forget the day during Advent on a Friday, she burst into my classroom at school. She's like, everybody needs to go home right now. I mean, the ground could have swallowed me up at this point. She said, Our Lady has appeared out the road at a shrine, and we all have to get out there to see what's happening. And our whole school closed down. And we went out the road, we walked together to the place where someone in our village had seen the Blessed Mother. And I was like, in seventh grade at the time, and I was like, you've got to be kidding me. And I remember everybody knelt down on the ground and the rain came. And I looked around and I saw the very elderly who had their knees replaced, kneeling, and dads helping moms and moms helping dads, and children looking at this space with such expectant anticipation, like, is she here? Is she here? Is she going to appear? Well, she didn't appear that day. And I sat down on a rock, and I was kind of like, she didn't appear to me. And my mom came up, and she said, I want you to look around at what's happening right now. I want you to look at our priest who's praying his rosary. I want you to look at the widow who lost his wife this summer. And the man next door to us whose child was killed in a terrible car accident. And all of us are together and we're praying. And the Blessed Mother is right here. Look around. She's here in the faith of your families, in your hopes, in the times when she's carried you through health issues, broken family issues, bullying, whatever stress in your life. You can be sure that the Blessed Mother, we don't often thank her, but she is like that wind beneath our wings that lifts us when we can't rise. So this is, I think this would be a great sister church to your church. I love the Blessed Mother so much that I really wanted to have a wedding that had the Blessed Mother at the center of it. And so I chose to get married on January 1st at 8:15 Mass, which my family did not thank me for. And I chose to carry a rosary beads and not have a cake. Someone said, why didn't you have a cake? And I'm like, because I just don't like cake. But I like little blue cupcakes and blue donuts. Somebody else is like, I don't like cake either. You like cake. And so the feast day of the Blessed Mother is January 1st, Mary, the Mother of God. But I wanted to be a mom so much. And in fact, myself and my husband were told we would never have children for a lot of different reasons. He had an injury, and we just weren't sure if we could have children. And so on this day, I remember standing in front of this little side altar at St. Mary Church in Algoma, which, by the way, was hand-carved by one of our priests. Like 150, 60 years ago, he hand-carved it. There's this beautiful statue to the Blessed Mother, but I am there smiling away at 8:15 in the morning. My whole family's like, oh, gosh, she got us up early. But with all of my hopes and my dreams kind of placed before her, because I wanted to be a mom so bad. And she blessed me. She blessed me with you guys say three, and we say tree in Irish. The Irish or Gaelic word for three, which you say with very nice pronunciation, is tree. Hain do tree. So if you hear me lapse into my Irish, that's why. But she's been an important part of my life. But strangely, I never had a statue of the Blessed Mother. You know how, hands up anyone that has a Blessed Mother statue in your garden, or like a rosary outside, or any statues outside. Anyone? I see a little hand here. Oh, don't be shy. Put them up so we can all see you. Okay, so some of you do, right? And we have a statue of Our Lady in our home, but we didn't have one in our garden. And so my husband's probably watching this on live stream, so I need to be very careful how I say this. But my husband is one of those guys who doesn't throw things away very easily. And he's like, oh, look, I found this, like, piece of rope on the side of the road. This could be handy for, you know, latching up deer or something, right? Or, like, look at this lovely pipe. We might need that for, like, do you know people like this, right? Or the mom who keeps the ball of wool or the quilting squares just in case you might need them. My husband is one of those guys. So, lo and behold, he goes to the dump one day. Yes, I said the dump. And look what he's driving along with. And he's like, he texts me. He's like, I know you said I shouldn't, like, go to the dump and bring home rocks or, like, go to the dump and bring home, like, mulch. But he goes, you're gonna love this. I can't tell you. And he drives up, and there is a statue, and it must be 150 pounds. It is one of the old, not hollow, concrete statues. And my heart broke because somebody had put the Blessed Mother and discarded her on top of the city dump. And my husband, the little scavenger that he was like, ooh, it's my wife's birthday next month. I will have to bring her home. And so she is Our Lady of the Immaculate Heart. Do you see in the center? She has that circle. And my daughter at the time, she was like, you know, Mom, Dad brings you home some unusual things, but this is one of the most strange ones. And she goes, I think she needs nicer makeup, she said to me. She meant, like, we should paint her up. But she was perfect. It's unusual to see in this picture here, but her face was gorgeous. And somebody had placed her on top of the wall overlooking the city dump, clearly didn't have the heart to completely discard her, but wanted somebody to see her. And then I was thinking about this, and I realized there was a lesson for me here. You know, Our Lady is a treasure, but sometimes she shows up at the times in our lives when we feel most dumped upon, when we feel most broken and discarded and just ugly. She is there. And I thought, this is Our Lady who meets us at the most awful times in our life. And she is our greatest treasure. Now, this is the first part of my story. There is actually a part two to this story. So I want you to remember this statue at the end of our time together. Can you do that for me? Okay. Now, there are a lot of titles for the Blessed Mother. Okay. There's Our Lady of the Immaculate Heart. What other titles have you heard of Mary? Our Lady of the Snows. I love that one. What else? Oh, Lady of Częstochowa. That's a very powerful one. That's one a lot of people don't know as much, I think. Our Lady of Fatima. Where else is associated with Our Lady? Nice and loud. Lourdes, Loreto. Yeah, her feast day was just recently. So we've got Częstochowa, Loreto, Lourdes, Fatima, Tepeyac, Cobijo, Our Lady of Guadalupe. Very good. Other names for Our Lady. How about Our Lady Queen of Peace? Our Lady Queen of Heaven? Our Lady of the Victory? Our Lady Queen of Grace? Our Lady Victorious? What other names do you know? Our Lady of Good Help. Very good. So the Door County Peninsula, the churches in the peninsula are known for a very specific title for Our Lady. Can anyone guess it? Mary of the Sea, Stella Maris. If you look at the Diocese of Green Bay, up and down the 16 counties of the Diocese of Green Bay, many of our parishes are named for Our Lady. I mean, and our titles, her titles tell us what she can do for us. Our Lady of Good Help, Our Lady of Hope, Our Lady of Grace. I don't know about you, but I feel like I need a lot of those attributes as well. So I want to give you, here's Our Lady now. Look at her, she's all cleaned up and she's in my garden. So I wanted to show you her, and I cleaned her, but I didn't paint her. And my daughter asked me why. And I said, as a reminder to me that she appeared in the places where humans discard things. And as a society today, we discard a lot. We discard the elderly, we discard the life of the unborn. We discard a lot. We can be very, very wasteful as people. So I left her on just as she was, as a reminder to me to never overlook places where people are feeling like life is dumping on them. Three places in my life where Our Lady has really been present to me. So this image is of Michelangelo. This is the Pieta. This is Our Lady holding her son Jesus. So Jesus died about the age of, anyone know? 33. Does anyone know what scholars suggest age-wise Mary may have been when she conceived Jesus? About 14. So this is an image of Mary at the age of about 45 to 47 when her son had passed away. A couple of years ago, I actually held the body of my second child, and it was very, very difficult for me. My child passed away 2 days after Christmas, and our children were upstairs sleeping, and my husband came in, and we sat and we held. This all happened at home, which is a whole other story, but we were able to hold the body of our child, and he said, you know, Our hearts were broken, but he said to me, no, Julianne, our children are sleeping upstairs, and in our hands, our loved one is sleeping right now. And I said to him, I don't think I can bear this pain. I don't think I can bear this pain. And he said to me, you have to bear this pain. You know, if the Blessed Mother can do it, she teaches us the way. You can do it too. And I said to him, I just can't. And he said, pray to her every single day. And so during that time in my life, my prayer to the Blessed Mother was always, I can't do this, Blessed Mother. Help me. Heal me. I'm sorry if I'm making some of you cry right now. I'm seeing like little discreet sniffles, and then I'm seeing like people in the full-on ugly cry. And it's okay, right? I know for many of you, this is a pain that you know well as well. So she got me through that very, very difficult time in my life. And then Think about the marvel of human life. The child that's growing. And Our Lady knew the pain of all of this. She knew the pain of losing a child, of watching her child being picked on and bullied. So she is there for us no matter what we go through in life. At some of the most painful moments in your life, call upon the Blessed Mother. She will light the way for you. And I've seen this in my life over and over and over again. Now, I show this image a lot, so indulge me. One of my favorite images of the Blessed Mother is this one. What do you notice? What's happening in this picture? If you've been to one of my talks and you've seen this, you might have heard this before, so I'm going to ask that you not kind of let the cat out of the bag. But what are you seeing here? So how many figures are in here? Maybe we'll ask the kids. There's three, right? So who are they? Is this Mary and Joseph? Okay. So what's Joseph doing in the back? Yeah, he's doing some carpentry. And then what color is Jesus' hair? If you get up close, it's actually red. It's a red-haired Irish Jesus, right? Because this is a window at St. Nicholas Cathedral in Galway. And then what do you notice about the Blessed Mother? What's going on here? Just don't say it out loud yet. So I have to tell you something funny. I did a talk for some people from Scotland. And I saw a kid put up their hand right away and said, "Ah, hi, Our Lady is playing the bagpipes." I was like, "No, Our Lady is not playing the bagpipes. She's doing something very, very Irish here. She's knitting. She is knitting. Some of you caught that. So Our Lady is sitting by the fire and she's knitting. And then what's Jesus got in his hand? A cup of tea. Yes. If it was an American Jesus, it would be coffee, right? But this is like Ireland's national drink, tea. And I love this image because to me, so many families come and say, it's really hard for us to find time to pray. It's really hard for us sometimes. We come into church and we're rushing, or it's just hard. Life is busy and it's frantic. And I'll say, choosing faith as a family is a choice that comes with no regrets. There is no regrets in having faith. It only will bless you and bless your family. And when I look at this image, I think about my own life. Like my husband is blowing something up in the garage or like rewiring something. We have a light in our house that when you turn it on at the bottom of the stairs, it doesn't actually turn off. You have to go all the way up to the top of the stairs to turn off the light. Because one day he decided to rewire that section of the house. So this is a familiar scene in my house, which is we've got Joseph is working on something, my husband's working on something, I'm busy, my hands are busy, and kids are running around asking for snacks and food, constantly. Your family can be holy just like the Holy Family, by being together, by nourishing your faith together, by keeping prayer at the heart of your life. So I want to share with you some theology, which is some wisdom from the church about Mary, and I've got a few other things to do. So what we believe as a Catholic Church about Mary shines an even greater light on Jesus Christ, because what it teaches about Mary illumines in turn its faith in Christ. So we cannot have a Catholic faith without Mary and Jesus. Now, a lot of folks who are not Catholic kind of question this a little bit. What kind of things have you heard other people say or other faiths say about Mary? We worship her. That's one that comes up a lot. What else? We pray to Mary. Those are two big ones. But actually, we ask Mary to pray for us. And we don't worship Mary. We have great praise and honor and devotion for her because she is the Mother of God. And I have a friend who's Lutheran said, I just don't get this Mary thing. And I said to her, okay, you and your husband love each other very much, right? She said, yeah. I said, do you feel as a mom that you understand because you held that child in, you know, the life of the child within you, that you just understand a little smidgen more about your child, like in a different way. It's not greater than. I see all the moms going, right? It's different. It's they complement each other. They complement each other. And she looked at me and I said, Mary teaches us other things about Jesus that we learn, that we need to learn. And she goes, why has no one ever explained it that simply to me? I'm like, I don't know. That's how I think of it. Well, she's now praying her rosary. So we're working on that one. So one of the first scripture accounts, and I wanted you to see some of the images tonight. These are images you don't typically see of the Blessed Mother. So when the angel Gabriel comes, he calls Mary full of grace. Hail Mary, full of grace. Mary cannot be full of grace if she is touched by sin, since sin diminishes grace. So Mary is sinless and perfect, which is hard for us to think about. So when the angel Gabriel comes to her, I love that she asked a question. But then after the angel Gabriel says to her, you are going to bear a child, Jesus, she says, let it be done unto me according to thy word. This is what's called her new fiat. So Mary becomes what's called the new Ark of the Covenant. Now, the Ark of the Covenant was one of the world's greatest treasures. This is what scientists, scholars, philosophers think the Ark of the Covenant would have looked like. It contained the ancient tablets of the Jewish law. So it was very, very precious. The Ark was only formed out of the most purest gold, which was mined on earth. But notice the two angel wings that come up and touch each other. Mary is described, according to St. Ambrose, as the Ark of the Covenant because she held the life of Jesus within her. So look at this. So you have St. Anne, who is Mary's mom. And then you have Mary, and look where they're all pointing to. They're pointing to Jesus. So Mary, one of the most ancient titles for Mary is the Ark of the Covenant because she gives us the word, and she gives us the author of the law. I love this image too. So in a sense, Mary becomes the mother of Jesus and the mother of God. This is one of my favorite images. I just want you to look at this. So it's a particular rendering of Our Lady, and we just had her feast day. What image is this of? It's a different image. It's Our Lady of Guadalupe. How do you know that? The stars on the tilma and the black belt. So Deanne, why is she wearing a black belt? Because she's with child. A black belt was the sign that a woman was a child. So if you see the images of Mary with a black belt, it's because it's showing that she is with child. So Mary is the mother of God. And here's this beautiful scripture. Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be done unto me according to your word. Look at this one. So, I once was giving a talk. Maybe I'll come back to this because I'll give the secret away. I was once giving a talk about St. Patrick, who is one of my favorite saints. Not just because he's Irish, but because he's awesome. And I often do talks at Irish Fest in Milwaukee, and they always give me the Saturday night talk, which... the parents will understand this. After a long day of revelry and entertainment at Irish Fest, my tent is right off the main stage. So I get a lot of people, I would say not walking into my tent, but maybe doing a little stagger. You get it, right? And I'm giving this talk about St. Patrick and how St. Patrick had this beautiful devotion to the Blessed Mother. And a hand goes up in the middle of the tent, and it's kind of like this, waving. And I'm like waving back, and then I realize, no, he's not like dancing. He's asking a question. And I said, okay, sir, you have a question? And he's like, how do you know any of this is real? And I was like, well, what do you mean, like? He's like, how do you know Patrick was like real? And I was like, do you mean like a real person? He's like, how do you know he ever lived? Like, this isn't all just made up. And everyone in the tent was like, you, hush, shh. We need to be present and listening to this talk. I said, no, it's okay. Let's have a conversation about that. I said, well, I've been to his grave. He said, Patrick has a grave? He said, well, yeah, he was a person. Like, we have historical records of his grave. I've been there. It's in a place called Downpatrick, which is up the north of Ireland. If that isn't Irish logic, I don't know what is. So up in Downpatrick is St. Patrick's grave. He's buried beside St. Bridget. I said, I've been to his grave. And then I had somebody else stood up and they said, I have had a relic of St. Patrick in my family for hundreds of years. So do any of our young people know what a relic is? Do you know what a relic is? A relic. There's a relic in this church. There's more than one. There's usually one in the altar. What's a relic? It can be a bone, it can be a piece of blood, it can be a piece of hair from a saint. And this person had stood up in my class and said, I have a piece of bone from St. Patrick, and I have the papers from the Vatican to prove it. I still have that relic and the papers in my house because that lady gave them to me that day. She's like, I have no children. I've wondered who to pass these along. You should have Patrick's bone. It's like, okay, I will take Patrick's bone into my house. And so we have a little place where we have a piece of St. Patrick's bone. And the documents are all authenticated. They're all signed and lodged at the Vatican, which is incredible. But here's the thing. No one has ever claimed to have relics of Mary. Although several cities have competed for the honor of being Mary's place of death, no city has ever claimed to have her body. No one has ever made pilgrimages to her tomb or venerated her bones as they did for the apostles and the early martyrs. There are cities around the world that are associated with Mary, but in the history of Christianity, we go to sacred sites to pray. St. Peter's tomb in Rome at the Vatican would be one. What other great shrines do we have around the world? Can you name any? Yeah, Our Lady of Good Help, Champion, Wisconsin. That's a shrine. The National Shrine of St. Joseph is in Green Bay too, which is incredible. Any other shrines that you know of? I'll tell you an unusual one. You heard of St. Valentine? St. Valentine's arm is in Ireland. It was gifted to the Irish people. If you go to Whitefriars Church and you look in, his arm is in the church. It's just incredible. There are no relics of Mary. There are no places of pilgrimage associated with her grave. Because, why? She was assumed into heaven. She was taken up. Her body was completely taken up into heaven. And we underestimate that all the time. In this church of the Blessed Assumption of the Blessed Mother of Mary, you stand as a community that says, we believe. We believe in our Catholic Church. We believe in the fullness of life after death. We believe in the Assumption of Mary. There's the Assumption. She was taken up, her entire body was taken up to heaven. That's what you say, believe it or not, with your body when you walk into this church. That you are part of a community that still believes in the Assumption of Mary. Is that not like mind-blowing? Almost 2,000 years later, from generation to generation, from father to son and grandmother to grandchildren, you are part of a community that loved the Blessed Mother so much that you built this incredible community, church, to say we believe. So when you look up, when you hear the priests say, this is my body given for you. And he lifts up the real presence of Jesus Christ, bodily, blood, soul, and divinity in the Eucharist. I want you to really look at that image of Our Lady. Because Jesus can say, this is my body given for you. Because the first person who gave her body was his mother. Think about that. Jesus can say that to us because she gave him her own body. It's an incredible, incredible gift. This is my favorite image of Mary and Elizabeth meeting each other. The two children in the womb danced for joy and they recognized each other. Mary is acclaimed by Elizabeth at the prompting of the Holy Spirit and even before the birth of her son as the mother of my Lord. So I don't know if your family prays the rosary, and no judgment here, but I'm going to tell you, one of the greatest weapons that you have in life is this. The rosary is an incredible, powerful way to pray and to protect yourself and your family. I happen to love this rosary. It's got the crucifix of St. John Paul II on it. It's got the Immaculate Heart of Mary, but I love the sound. Can you hear it? When you pray with these beads, they warm up in your hand. So I'm going to send them around so you can feel them and kind of touch them. But the rosary teaches us so much about Mary's life. So this is one of the, this is Mary's life through the rosary a little bit. The Annunciation. So there's an announcement to her. This is Father John Gerotti's favorite image of the Blessed Mother. Can you imagine? She was just told she was going to bear Jesus Christ. She's like, how is that possible? He's like, through the power of the Holy Spirit. I wonder what must have been going through her head. Or here, when she meets to help her cousin Elizabeth. Or when she takes her son Jesus to the temple and presents him in the temple. You know, did you hear the gospel this weekend where Jesus ran away? I don't know, has anybody ever had a child run away? As a parent? Okay, I see you looking at each other like, oh, do you remember that time? Okay. Has anyone ever run away? Like, pretend, like, my six-year-old had packed a backpack and was going down. Yeah, okay. Oh, very interesting. Some of you are like, yep. I think we've all had times in our life where we kind of want to run away. My daughter went missing in a store, and we could not find her. And it was a very, very large store in Green Bay, and I have absolute panic on my face. I am like a military general, and I say to my husband, you go stand at the door so nobody can get out of this door, and you will tackle them. You will bring them down. Like, I am thinking Liam Neeson vibes here. And I am in the bathroom. You just don't, right? You're just frantic out of your mind. We were in the store. There were announcements made. The security guards were looking for her. We could find her nowhere. So then we placed a call to the, it was terrible, frightening, to the police department. My husband's like, you know, Julianne, the first couple of hours is critical. I was like, stop right now. I was like, my mind was just going. And all of a sudden, we hear this woman scream in the back of the store. My husband and I just ran. Our daughter had climbed up under the racks of clothes and had seen a really cute pair of shoes. And as a lady came to pick out her sweaters, my daughter decided to be touching and massaging this lady's feet and her nice shoes. You can laugh because I didn't at the time. And this lady was screaming her head off because all she could see was two hands massaging her little ankles, right? The blind panic that you face when you don't know where your children is. And in the scriptures, we have this reading this week of, oh, he's gone for 3 days. Jesus is gone in Jerusalem for 3 days. And Mary comes to the temple to find him, and he's like, oh, I got this, Mary. Literally, he says to her, I am gone to my father's house. Like, don't worry about this. I don't know about you, but at that point, Our Lady Queen of Grace, Our Lady of Peace, all of those things, Our Lady of the Hot Temper, I think we forget sometimes Our Lady was a human being. She felt what we felt. She got worried. She was anxious. She cried. She wept over her son. She must have been, and it says it in one of the translations of the scriptures, frantic with worry. So to go from this moment where she presents her beautiful son in the temple to he is gone for 3 days, she has gone through it all. I was sitting with a beautiful Hispanic woman recently, and I said she hadn't been able to go to church because she's homebound. And I said to her, what holds you together when days are dark? And she said to me, oh, the Mama Jesus, the Mama Jesus. That's how she called the Blessed Mother, the Mama Jesus. So she knows those worries. This is Bishop Ricken's favorite image of Our Lady. This is when the Holy Spirit came down and filled the Blessed Mother. It's a really unusual image. Here's an unusual one here where she's crowned and she's holding the scriptures. And she's in blue and she's jeweled and she's just splendorous and gorgeous. But now I want to get real a little bit here. We are also told that Mary will crush the head of Satan. And that is an image that you see in classic art. You see the snake, and you see her lovely feet, her little tootsies, and she is stomping on his head. What is that about? I've been praying about this a lot. I think in our world today, the media is really out of control. I see you nodding. This last 2 years has been really tough. You feel like you can't say anything. Like, are you going to bite my head off? Like, can we talk about this? Can we not? Right? Conversations are getting harder and harder to have with people. Some families are telling me they feel a lot of division. Some people are saying they feel very discouraged right now. I call this, these are the seven things that Mary crushes and helps us with. The first one is dismissal. Whenever we feel like we've been dismissed in life, like you're too young, you're too small, you're not smart enough, Mary reminds us that no one is too small to God. Everyone is important and special and loved. One of the things that the enemy does, and I'm just going to use that as the term for the serpent here, is he tries to get people to distort the truth. Oh, that's not too bad. It's okay if you do that when you clearly know right from wrong. Okay, Mary helps us crush that desire in our lives. Distraction. Have you noticed people on the road sometimes? Oh my goodness, I was driving up here and there is a lady and she is on her phone and she is combing her eyebrows as I'm driving up. Right past on 29, I'm like, what are you doing, lady? Put your hairbrush down for your eyebrows. Like, I'm literally driving and I'm looking in going, you are a distracted driver. But it seems like you walk in the high school, earbuds are in, scrolling on the phone. You go out to a restaurant, everyone's on their iPad or their games or their Apple devices and they're checking them, right? I'm guilty of that myself. One of the ways that I think Our Lady helps us is to tell us, don't be distracted. Can you just give 5 minutes to God today? Can you pray an extra Hail Mary? Can you pray a Hail Mary on the way home after this talk together? Can you come to church and just sit here and just thank Our Lady and notice something? Don't be afraid. Come up and look at, I have really bad eyes, but I'm sure there's lots of details up there. And you with young eyes are going to see just incredible detail in her face. Notice where she is. Duplicity is another word for lies. The enemy or Satan is called the father of lies. And this is what he does. You're too stupid. Don't go to mass today. Just stay in bed. Nobody will notice if you're there anyway. Don't pray. Why would you bother praying? Just go and do whatever you like in life. Oh, you can have whatever you want. You can do whatever you want. He's the father of lies because it's not true. And I think for the parents, this is a very deep point. Jesus Christ will always call you by your name because in the scriptures we hear this, I have called you by name and you are mine. So he knows us and he loves us. But the devil will always call us not by our name but our shame. The thing that we are most not proud of in life, the devil will use that against us. For example, liar, alcoholic, thief, addict, divorcee, whatever it is that gnaws at our peace, the evil one will call us by our shame. And in the places of our heart where we think, oh gosh, thank God I'm beyond that, there's still places where we took the hurts from a long time ago. Our Lady says, shut those noises down. We've all made mistakes. And she stands in front of us to say, God loves you. He's merciful. He's with you. You are his precious, precious child. No one can take anything away from you if you have that love that he's given you in your heart. You are enough. You are enough. It's a beautiful point. I created a little handout of these. I won't go through them. But the biggest one I will say right now is, and I see a lot of our priests that struggle a little bit of this, they get discouraged. I think it's easy to get discouraged today. Like Bishop always says to me, don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good. Don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good. So discouragement. Mary instead reminds us that we should be encouraged. Now, I understand last week you talked about Our Lady of Guadalupe, right? And you talked about the miracles that are associated with the tilma. So you've seen this. But scientific studies have not been able to discover the origin of the coloration nor the way that this image was printed. No brush strokes have been detected. It's been scientifically analyzed. In fact, NASA analyzed the paint. Did you hear about this last week a little bit? So it's just a little recap. If you weren't here last week, this is the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe, which was painted on cactus fibers. It was supposed to last 50 years, but it has survived for hundreds of years. The rough material of the tilma has a span of no more than 20, 30. It can stretch to 50 sometimes. But during the 500 years of the miracle, the cloth with the image of Mary remains as it was on the first day. Scientists cannot explain this. This is one that's not well known. In 1791, anyone ever worked at muriatic acid? That stuff is nasty. It eats at everything. Like my husband used it to clean concrete sometimes, and that stuff is corrosive. Muriatic acid was spilled on the upper right corner of the tilma. During the period of 30 days without any treatment, the tilma rebuilt itself. It seems to be a living, breathing organism. NASA can't explain it. Science can't explain it. It's incredible. So this is one of my favorite images of the Blessed Mother, but there are three apparitions that I really want to share with you. Oh, I have got to do a little thing with you. Lourdes, Our Lady of Good Help, and Knock in Ireland. Look at the dates. 1858, 1859, and 1879. Our Lady always appears to the poorest, most simple, to families, to those who are in most need. And I think the French people, the people of the Diocese of Wisconsin, and the Irish are connected by Our Lady in a very special way. I remember I did this research and I was like, this is incredible. These apparitions were within like 20 years of each other. And everyone's like, okay. And I'm like, no, these are the three biggest apparitions at the time. Irish and Wisconsin and the French people are all linked through Our Lady. And someone said, that's because you just came here to Wisconsin. You're just looking for an Irish link anywhere you are. Partly that's true. But I want to show you why the French apparition is so interesting. Because Our Lady of Lourdes appeared to St. Bernadette when she was only 14. Okay, and there were 18 apparitions of her. Here is St. Bernadette. I actually went to visit her house in Lourdes a couple of years ago. Very, very poor. The family was living in abject poverty. After Bernadette died, her body remained what's called incorruptible, and her body is still fresh today. On December 8th, 1933, she was canonized a saint. Her feast day is April 16th. Here is St. Bernadette as she appeared in 1879. Okay? This is St. Bernadette today. That's miraculous. Does this not just give you chills? I have seen her body with my own eyes. It is Incredible. Incredible. Our Lady of Knock, one of the only apparitions in the world where Our Lady said nothing. And we always joke in Ireland that she couldn't say anything because the Irish women were chattering away. She appeared with St. John the Baptist and St. John. This is the mosaic in the chapel. It's composed of millions of little tiny pieces of mosaic. And here's a modern rendering of what that apparition would have looked like. She appeared to hundreds of people in Knock in Ireland. St. John Paul II went to visit her. Now, I promised you a little story about Our Lady. But this summer, I found myself in times of trouble. Anyone know that song? Sing it with me. When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me. All the teenagers are like, what is this? So we'll do it one more time. When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Okay, it is a Beatles song, but this was a song I found myself singing this summer because our front tree came down and took out our entire fence line. And this was the picture doesn't do this justice, but it was a birch that you could not get your arms around. Do you remember that lady? Remember Our Lady of the dump that my husband came speeding home in his car with? I want you to see this. Can you see her in here? Hang on, this is a storm. You can clearly see all the destruction, right? Our trampoline's in the corner, it's all destroyed. Fence line is knocked out. Look. Look again. She is completely standing. The statue my husband had saved the summer before was the only thing standing. There'll be lots of storms in life. Stay close to Jesus. And when the storm hits, stay even closer to Mary. And she'll be right with you. So I want to share with you just very, very briefly a little what's called a visio divina. I love contemporary Christian music, but I actually prefer classical Christian music like Ave Maria. But with this story of Let It Be, I want you to listen to that song, Let It Be, and I'm going to show you some images, pardon me, of the Blessed Mother. I'll just get out of here. And I just want you to just sit and give thanks to her while I get this light show going. Here we go. Bear with me.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be. Let it be.
Let it be. There will be an answer.
But I hope that when you hear the words, let it be done unto me, that you'll remember the great love that our Blessed Mother has for every one of you. I want to point out one thing. Father Edward Looney, who is a Marian scholar, has written a little guide to Our Lady as the first and best disciple, and we put this together for you tonight. It's something that you can do together as a family, you can read. So I'm going to leave them maybe over with Deanne. And you can take those on your way out. And the last one is for those that want to read a little bit about the seven D's of darkness that Our Lady crushes for us. There's an article there. So I want to thank you for praying with me tonight. Let it be done unto me according to thy word was Mary's great fiat, or her yes to God. And may each one of us express that great love in saying yes to God every day. I want to thank you again for being here, and we're going to close with a Hail Mary tonight. I'd love to sing the Salve Regina, but probably won't do that with you. I'm not always the greatest singer. So let's close with a simple Hail Mary, and I want you to just meditate, look up to the image of Our Lady of the Assumption, remembering the great love that God has for each one of us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So God, our Father, we thank you for the gift of being together as a parish community, for growing in faith, for parents and grandparents who want to pass on our Catholic faith with such great devotion to your children. We ask that you inspire in us greater love and devotion to the Blessed Mother as we pray together tonight as one community of faith. Hail Mary. And blessed is the fruit.
Holy Mary, Mother of God,
in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you so much. Blessed Advent and safe travels home.
All right. Thank you, Julianne. Thank you so very much. We go home not only with Jesus on our mind and Mary, but Mary in our hearts as well. So thank you for your sharing your beautiful soul and your heartwarming stories. Thank you, Julianne. You're a blessing for all of us. Happy Advent to you, too.